You know what's on the big stage right now? The really big stage. The big stage is focused on the fact that Jesus is back. And keep in mind that when he was resurrected, he appeared to a number of people, and they didn't recognize him. They did not recognize him. And it was only after a bit of Jesus saying, "Hey, you know, don't you see who I am?" Or a little bit of time, a little bit of conversation, that people that he appeared to would say, "Oh, it's you. Wow." So we should expect when Jesus returns, as he has already returned, actually, that very few will recognize him. We might have a problem recognizing this fact. And we'll be a little bit slow on the uptake here, which we certainly are. We're a little slow on the uptake. But not here. Not here. We've been expecting this, told to expect it, prepared for it. And this is the big news item that absolutely pushes everything else into the recycle bin, actually, as far as news goes. And it's amazing. It's just the most incredible experience to see the world just going on like nothing has happened, still paying attention to all this political turmoil, social turmoil, all this stuff, just spinning their wheels with all this nonsense, really, when the fact is that Jesus is back in the world. And this is the huge, huge, monumental story right now as far as news goes. Why would anyone be paying attention to the other stuff that's going on right now? This is the big news. This is the big news. So we're breaking this great news story on this YouTube channel here. Jesus has returned to this world. Jesus is now here. I don't know whether in spirit or in body, but what's important is his mind, his attention has returned to us fully, and in a mode of relating to us as friends. And he's letting this be known that his mission has, so to speak, has shifted into this new phase. And this is what we call the return of Christ. Now, the latest poll had the United States about 70% see them identify themselves as Christians, but you don't see any Christian representation on television as far as crosses or religious symbols on television, nor do you see them in commercials. If you look at commercials, there's no identification of anyone as Christians, actually. Yet 70% of the country is Christian, with only less than 1% of other types of religions here, actually. Hindu, Muslim, Jewish, Judaism, and less than 1%. And so 70% identify themselves as Christians, and yet you would think that it would be 0%. If you look at public life, if you go around, you would think it's 0%. When you see these churches, you say, what are those for? You know, if you're watching television, I don't know who goes there. I mean, I don't see any indication that there are any Christians at all left in the world, so to speak here. Very odd indeed. And this is on purpose, of course, but it's all too late. It's all to no avail. All of this effort by cosmic corporate culture to deceive us here is didn't work. Okay, wasted time. Jesus hasn't forgot about us. Jesus has returned, and he is now here, and he is going to do what he's going to do. So welcome to the video, and we're in this wonderful time of breaking the story, and that's what I'm doing. So that's why I'm spending so much time talking about this. And as far as the time goes, well, you know, we'll go to a movie, watch the movie, it's a couple hours, 2.5 hours maybe, go out to dinner, come home. We might, you know, spend an evening going to a movie. We spend an evening watching a baseball game, watching a movie on television, watching the various shows. You might start 8 o'clock watching television, watch through 11:30 or 12 o'clock, go to sleep. nobody thinks anything about doing that. Well, you're absolutely, you know, when you do that, you're absolutely spending a huge concentrated block of time opening your mind to victim consciousness, it's called. Opening your mind to victim consciousness, huge block of time. All we're doing is saying reverse that and spend a huge block of time opening your mind to truth consciousness, okay, to truth consciousness, which is the truth. Victim consciousness is an arrogant lie, okay? It's sheer arrogance. That's all that it is. So it's just amazing how, I would say, the world is unprepared for the return of Jesus. I said, Jesus, is anyone going to even, you know, is anyone prepared for you? It would be, isn't it going to be interesting to find out who has prepared properly? That is for sure. Now, many people in the world think that, God, religion has to do with survival. It's a survival religion. And that God teaches us how to survive as human beings, as if God is the creator of human beings, and it's God's purpose to teach human beings how to survive better, how to live a better life and survive. Survival religions. Actually, Jesus completely repudiated that by the crucifixion. He said, no, it's not about survival of the human body. It's not about that at all. Okay, it's about eternal life as spirit. I am not a body, I am free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. It's about that. Okay, it's 100% about that. So we are going to venture a little bit here, if I can, do this new, a sort of a new type of program. If I can get some content of on the internet that I can relate to you as part of this sort of breaking this huge, huge news story, which is my privilege to be breaking this story, because it's been my purpose to pay attention to this. It's been my business to pay attention to it. And I don't want to miss it. I don't want to miss it. Why would we want to miss it? Jesus, why is Jesus so important? Because Jesus is the great advocate of truth consciousness. And more than that, you would say the primary advocate of dropping victim consciousness. As far as I'm concerned, when it comes to dropping victim consciousness, Jesus is just very, very much preeminent. Okay. Now, Jesus taught in parables when he was here. And because he said we wouldn't understand if he taught us directly. And he said, later on, I'll teach you directly. Which he did. He made good on that promise, which is actually, for those who have ears to hear it, it's A Course in Miracles, actually, is from Jesus teaching us more directly, which he promised to do. And why isn't this not opening up? I don't know. Can we get, you know, it's saying save it, PDF. Oh, well, best plans. So I want to, well, it's not cooperating with us. That's okay. The typical on the internet, right? That you just, it's just a grab bag. All right, we'll try another link here. We're going to talk about the parables. So when he first came, he gave these parables. And what I'm getting at here is what he seemed to be getting at is, don't wait until I return. See, I think most people are saying when Jesus returns, they say, great, when he returns, then I'm going to start listening and paying attention. Otherwise, forget it, you know. Whereas he said, no, don't wait until I return. I'm promising you that I will return. And if you do anything, be sure to prepare, because you don't know the day and the hour that I'm going to return. And I come back like this and you're not ready. That is not a good situation. weddings and feasts, lost and found, father and son. So they have a list of parables here. Not all of them have links. Prodigal son, the good Samaritan, the lost sheep, the shepherd and the thief and the doorkeeper. So I guess there's a whole lot of parables, about 47 parables that Jesus gave in the Bible. It's amazing. I didn't know there was that many. And this is how he taught. But it's for the most part. Now that we've been able to have A Course in Miracles, we're way more advanced than we used to be, where we're capable of hearing directly, okay, directly. So we start out with the parable of the so we can talk about these. Oh, they don't have links on all these. How about that? You can't always get what you want, right? So maybe we wouldn't have to do this. We understand directly. We can now hear directly without parables. This is the point. We can hear directly from Jesus and understand what Jesus is saying without the use of parables. But you know, what's the parable of the bridesmaids or something that they don't prepare? In the parable of going away, he goes away, and the master of the house goes away and says, you know, take care of my estate while I'm gone. And some do, and some don't. Let me see if I can get any of those here. Ours things are just completely failing me. It'd be nice, you know, if they had links instead of just a list with no links, so you could actually read the parable. So bear with us. My point again. No, they don't have any links at all. Isn't that something? He said, prepare while I'm gone. Because when I come back, you won't have time to prepare, okay? You won't have time. It'll be too late then. The ones about the bridesmaid or something, they're going to a wedding feast and they have to go, they haven't kept their lamps trimmed and didn't have oil They come and then it's time for the wedding and they have to go out and get oil, and then when they come back from getting the oil, the door is shut, right? It's shut. They can't get in. Well, everybody has their own. You see, this is the thing about looking at parables. Empty house, empty lamps. The foolish virgins. Parable of the foolish virgins. Get ready, okay, well, okay. The empty lamps. Okay. Well, they don't give the actual. Don't even give what the parable is. This is some teaching thing, but it doesn't even tell you what the parable is. Well, we're not getting anywhere here, so it isn't meant to be. Amazing. Absolutely amazing. It's something this important. Doesn't have any easy way to get to it on the internet here. Invitation to a wedding banquet, parable number 40. The wise and foolish virgins, that's 13 and 43 and 44. Okay. But this is the one that you have to download it. No way to get to this. I thought it would be an easy. I thought it would be easy. It's not easy at all. Crazy. Are you kidding me? The parables of Jesus, I mean. And they don't, they're not going to. Let me see if Wikipedia has anything. I mean, the internet is just, it takes infinite patience to wade through all this stuff, doesn't it? And you never know what you're going to get. It's not quite what you want. You just want a list and just give the scripture. I mean, is that difficult? No, you can't get that. So we'll take a look at Wikipedia, if Wikipedia can do anything. And let me see if they Probably not. They're just going to blah, 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 blah. Now it. I'm just looking at the computer here, getting all philosophical about it. No, they have a bunch of artwork. It's about artwork, poetry, hymns, harmony of this, harmony of that. Maybe we can get it here. They try. Parables of wedding feast. Oh my gosh. No. Can't find it. Wow. Just 10 virgins. I don't know if that's the one. The foolish virgins, the great banquet. Two sons. I don't know. There's no easy way here. This is just amazing. Okay. Parable of the wise and foolish virgins narrative. Are they going to actually give it? Yes, they actually did. Isn't that amazing? Then the kingdom of heaven will be like 10 virgins who took their lamps and went out to meet the bridegroom. 5 of them are foolish and 5 are wise. Those who were foolish, when they took their lamps, took no oil with them, but the wise took oil in their vessels with their lamps. Now while the bridegroom delayed, they all slumbered and slept. But at midnight there was a cry, "Behold, the bridegroom is coming. Come out and to meet him." Then all those virgins arose and trimmed their lamps. The foolish said to the wise, "Give us some of your oil, for our lamps are going out." But the wise answered, saying, "What if there isn't enough for us and you? You go rather to those who sell and buy for yourselves." While they went away to buy, the bridegroom came, and those who were ready went in with him to the marriage feast, and the door was shut. Afterward, the other virgins also came, saying, "Lord, Lord, open to us." But he answered, "Most certainly I tell you, I don't know you. Watch, therefore, for you don't know the day nor the hour in which the Son of Man is coming." Now, Jesus referred to himself as the Son of Man. Okay, so this is really about the return of Jesus. And what it's saying is, you better have the oil in your lamps. You better have the repentance in your mind already when he returns. It's because when he comes, it's going to be too late, because it's now, and the door opens and then it's shut, so to speak. You can't say, "Okay, now I'm going to begin, because now I realize what you said was true when you said you returned. So now I believe you. So now I'm going to start working on repentance." Jesus said, no. The first coming was to tell us to prepare for the second coming by repenting. And at the second coming, the world will be in such collapse that we will have needed to already be repentant at that time. Our lamps need to be filled with oil so the light will burn, you see, at that time. And we don't have time to go out in the marketplace and buy oil. So, and also we ask those who already have some, give it to me. Repentance is not a thing that can be given. Repentance is not a thing that can be given. Okay, it's not a product that you can take from somebody else. It's impossible. It's something, it has to do with setting down your own arrogance and the fears that you have in doing that. It's an inner work that you do with your own belief system. So you can't get it from somebody else, and that like it's a commodity. It's impossible. So I know a lot of people in the world are trying to get power. They know Jesus is returning, and they're trying to get social power and social leverage so they can, an entitlement, so they can demand that you give them some of your repentance so they can get into heaven, as if it was a commodity like that. This is a great mistake that they've made. In my case, I just work on repentance, and did not work for any social position whatsoever. So I don't have any entitlement. I don't have any leverage over anyone. So it's all, either have repentance or I don't. And you can't get it from someone else. It's not like you can go and repossess, a car, someone's car, repossess their house, demand they give you your bank account or stocks or, it doesn't work that way. So you have all these people in the world frantically striving for political power over others. thinking that in doing so that they will be able to steal, you know, what you have, repentance, and get it from themselves, and then get a great place, you know, in quote unquote heaven. Get a better house than you, so to speak. This is a losing strategy, and Jesus in the parable of the 10, the wise and foolish virgins, points this out that it's a drastic mistake. Don't make this mistake. Do not make this mistake. Well, of course, a lot of us have. So, but for those who have repented, they realize those are the wise ones. They spent their time, the workers. What would you like to hear? I don't know if you let me just go over the names of some of these. The growing seed, the two debtors, lamp under a bushel, parable of the good Samaritan, the friend at night, the rich fool, the wise and the foolish builders, new wine into old wineskins. We probably heard of that one. Parable of the strong man, parable of the sower, the tares, the barren fig tree, parable of the mustard seed, the leaven, parable of the pearl, drawing in the net, the hidden treasure, counting the cost, the lost sheep, or the good shepherd, the unforgiving servant, the lost coin, parable of the prodigal son, the unjust steward, rich man and Lazarus, the master and the servant, the unjust judge, Pharisees and the publican, the workers in the vineyard, the two sons, the wicked husbandman, and this page is just frozen up. Now I'm going for the wicked husband, the great banquet, the budding fig tree, the faithful servant, the 10 virgins, which we just heard, the talents or minus, the sheep and the goats. Might have heard of that one. Parable of the wedding feast, parable of the sower, parable of the tares. Oh, this is, what is this? Parables outside the canonical gospels. Parable of the pearl, parable of the hidden treasure, parable of the rich fool. So, it's parable of the strong man. There you go. These are the parables. So, what are some of the ones we've heard? Let me see. Parable of the wedding feast. A lot of these seem to be in Luke. Parable of the wedding feast. Now, let's see. Workers in the vineyard. Some of these parables are difficult to understand. That's for sure. And this is what they often use in church, to use these parables. But these parables are you know, I have a, you know, tough time with them. I don't really. You can look at it in a million different ways, which is, see, this is the thing, is parables. The reason why he taught in parables, he says, I have to teach in parables to you. He didn't want to. He said, I have to. I have to teach in parables because you cannot tolerate direct teaching. The thing about parables is that you can interpret them in a million different ways, and so it makes you feel like safe from the right interpretation, because we're so afraid of truth. We're so afraid of truth that we say, well, this might be this way, or it might be this way, or it might be this way. And it makes us think, and we kind of, what we do, it makes us kind of consider, what is the truth? What is truth? How can I look at this right way? Instead of just being told directly what is truth. We didn't used to be ready for that. We couldn't handle this. We couldn't handle the truth. And there's a parable of the new wine skins. And he spake also a parable unto them. Jesus is his response. No man putteth a piece of a new garment upon an old. If otherwise, then both the new maketh a rent, and the piece that was taken out of the new agreeth not with the old. And no man putteth new wine into old bottles, else the new wine bottle will burst the bottles, and be spilled, and the bottles shall perish. But new wine must be put into new bottles, and both are preserved. No man also, having drunk old wine straightway, desireth new, for he saith, the old is better. Ah, interesting. And then they give all sorts of interpretations. All sorts of interpretations. So, the parables just leave it very wide open. I mean, what's he saying there? You can look at it a lot of different ways. Why he said, you know, he's talking about the old. Well, he means that what you're familiar with, you're going to say is better. What you're familiar with, you're going to say is better. And so, when you bring in the new teachings, for instance, when Jesus brought in A Course in Miracles, which is new wine, and, well, even when Jesus brought in the New Testament, that was very new teaching for the times. And what happened was the apostles and those who wrote the Gospels, they tried to graft it onto the old. They said, wow, this is just too new for us. We prefer the old, but we don't want to reject this, so let us kind of integrate the two. And so you got a lot of sacrificial language of talking about Jesus as the Lamb of God. I know John wrote about a lot about that. And this is the atoning sacrifice, and you know that that we need, that is a perpetual sacrifice. But you know, it's a funny thing about that whole thing about the Lamb of God, because what did the Jews use lambs for a sacrifice? To protect themselves from evil spirits, from destruction by demonic forces. And so they took a lamb that they owned, the best lamb that they owned, and they sacrificed it. And they felt this protected them from evil. Okay. But then they called Jesus the Lamb of God. So that means this is the lamb that God owns, and that God then sacrificed this lamb. Well, then that would mean that God is now protected from evil spirits and evil by sacrificing his lamb, his prized lamb. Why does God need to be protected from evil spirits, from evil? Very interesting if you look at it this way. And what we're doing here is we're celebrating the return of Jesus, which is actually already happened. And so we're celebrating by focusing on Jesus. It's time, you know. Give Jesus his due. He said he'd come back, and he did. He said he'd speak to us more directly. He fulfilled that promise. He already did that. Getting back to that, so the example back then when the New Testament came, the Jews of the time, most of the early Christians were Jews. Okay, all the apostles were. And they were so used to the Jewish religion and all the practices that they couldn't let go of it. They had to say, no, Jesus has got to be this, you know, this. We have to sacrifice to protect ourselves from evil. And Jesus is the perfect sacrifice that will protect us from evil, from all, always. Or they could be saying that God is now permanently protected from evil by sacrificing this perfect lamb. And so now we can trust God, heaven, to be a nice place for us. Won't be any evil there. You know, this is, I think, at the back of their minds, they didn't say this, but this certainly makes sense as far as this is what they were saying, because God was sacrificing his own lamb. Why would anyone do that in their religion? That would mean that God is now getting permanent protection from evil, or trying to get permanent protection from evil. Does God need to be protected from evil? See, does pure spaciousness need to be protected from some sort of appearance that appears within it? So now here comes the new Jesus said, speaking to us directly instead of parables. A Course in Miracles. He made good on his promise. And what did a lot of people do? They said, oh, you know, the old tastes better. The old wine is better. We like the old wine better. And they reject the new wine. All right. In my case, I was ready for the new wine. I was tired of the old wine. I said, you know, it's I want something much more direct. Okay. And that was it. Of Course in Miracles was it. And so I jumped on it and said, this is it. And got super familiar with it, of the direct way, the very, very direct way. Way better. It's way better. It's much less wiggle room. Much, much less wiggle room. Helps you focus in. So there's a perfect example, and many Christians rejected it. Rejected Jesus, essentially. Because they said, no, I like the old stuff better. I like the parables better. Because in the parables, you always can always feel that you're kind of might be right. because nobody knows exactly what it means necessarily. You know, you get 10 people, they're going to give you 10 different interpretations of the parables for sure. And I know in Catholic Church, they always, you know, use these parables, and they say, okay, we're going to focus on this parable, and this is what Jesus, and the priest tells you that this is what Jesus meant by it. And I'm sitting listening, says, what? You know, I says, that's not what he meant by it. What are you talking about? You know, and I'm sure a lot of people are thinking, huh, I got a kind of a different interpretation. It's very open to interpretation, which a frightened mind likes that. Okay, the mind that believes that dropping our arrogance will result in annihilation is in no hurry to drop their arrogance. So they'll say, yes, God, I'm studying your word. I'm studying your word, and I'm really working on it. But, you know, the whole time they're saying, well, I'm not really sure what it means. I'm not really sure what it means. It might be this, might be this, might be this. And so they feel like safe from all the dreadful, you know, horrors that they feel dropping arrogance might cost them. Because they say, oh, I can't quite drop it yet, God, because I'm not quite sure what you meant by this parable. Whereas if Jesus speaks directly, there's no wiggle room. You know, you realize, wow, if I'm holding on to is arrogance, plain and simple. No exceptions, no wiggle room. So it's a tough path. The path of getting truth directly is difficult and stressful and can cause a lot of anxiety, actually, which it caused me a lot of anxiety, a lot of dread. I think every time I read a Course of Miracles, I thought I was going to be annihilated. You know, say, my God, you know, what's going to happen to me? What's going to happen to me? You know, it was terrifying. and fortunately, it was not annihilated. At all. But certainly part of me was saying, you know, you can't read this stuff. I mean, this is crazy. What are you doing? You're too risky. It's too risky. And of course, you know, arrogance protects itself by claiming if it stops, it will be annihilated, which is nonsense. Total lie, which is, you know, arrogance. What does it do? It lies. It says, this is true. It doesn't, and just whatever wants to be true, it says, this is true. If I stop arrogance, I'm going to be annihilated. You know, this is just arrogating something which has no, doesn't exist in reality whatsoever. So this is what we've been doing. And so new wine can be quite frightful for us. There's no question about it. And so we struggle. Of course we're going to struggle. Absolutely, of course we're going to struggle with that. And yet Jesus says that's the struggle we need to make. And we've given us a couple thousand years to get after it. And A Course in Miracles was published in about 1976, around there. So we've had almost 40 years to get after that. Yeah, almost 40 years to get after it. That's a good long time. So, I'm not going to go over all these parables because, like I said, it's they're subject to so many, many interpretations. Plus, a lot of the parables were meant to speak to people of that time, who the symbology and the illusion, what it was alluding to. Was something that the people back then would understand. No data received. Well, that's one way to block it, you know. It just a parable of the budding fig tree. He told them a parable. See the fig tree and all the trees. When they are already budding, you see it and know by your own selves that the summer is already near. Even so, you also, when you see these things happening, know that the kingdom of God is near. Most certainly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all things are accomplished. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will by no means pass away. In other words, truth never passes away. Whereas all appearances do pass away, the truth of reality never passes away, which is what we're perfectly free. We're absolutely free, pure spaciousness. God is pure love, pure spaciousness, never, no preferences, no, never rejecting whatever we want to experience, whatever sort of appearance experiencing we want. We're perfectly free to do that. But all appearances being appearances, we will move on from them. But the truth of our spiritual will and perfect freedom remains. It always remains. So in this, he's talking about the parable of the fig tree. He's talking about the end times. When will you know that they are here? Matthew, Mark, and Luke is about the kingdom of God. And this is Luke 21:29. It's eschatological in nature, meaning he's talking about the end times. And he's saying, how will you know about the end times? Well, like a fig tree. And there's something to do with Israel here, but the reestablishing of Israel is likened to, I believe, a fig tree. And when you see the fig tree blooming, you know the summer is near. In other words, when you see the events in the world taking place, which we've been alerted to, we know the return of Jesus is near. And that generation will experience it. And so we're at that right now, and we are experiencing it. We are experiencing a quantum collapse. I call it a quantum collapse right now of intelligence in the world. And I am paying a little bit of attention to this just to monitor it. And truly, the lack of common sense, the lack of a common goal, is astonishing in this world, and people are simply spinning their wheels, making fools out of themselves, I have to say. Absolute buffoonery is taking place by people who are on television who are supposed to be pontificating about the truth. I mean, they are just gasping for air. They cannot think in a cohesive, logical, reasoned manner because they've lost sight of the prize. They don't know what their goal is. Their goal is to try to make lies true, ultimately. This is the goal of arrogance. Now, how does arrogance pursue this goal? Well, what it does is arrogance requires a massive amount of belief, a massive amount of defenses, belief-based defense systems, to protect it, to camouflage it, so we don't see it, so we don't see reality as it is. These defenses cause us incredible misery, and yet we feel bound by them, that we have to have them, otherwise we'd recognize our arrogance, we'd recognize that arrogance is non-causative, and we think we'd lose our contest with God, except guess what? There is no contest with God. This is also part of our arrogance. And we think we'll be annihilated, which there is no annihilation in God whatsoever. This is also part of our arrogance. But we're terrified to recognize that arrogance doesn't have any causation to it. No causation. It's nothing. We just have to drop it. So we defend against this with these huge defensive systems, you know, massive, that just make us feel so unfree and bound and miserable and frightened and terrified. You know, we're just shaking in dread and we're just desperate to maintain these defenses. So what we tell ourselves is that when we hold on to these defenses long enough, eventually we'll be able to make lies true, which means we'll be able to make arrogance causative. And we think that as soon as we do that, we believe that we don't need the defense systems anymore to defend arrogance. And so we'll be able to get rid of our defense systems and we won't suffer anymore from them. Because that's what we're really suffering from, is these defense systems. What we normally are experiencing in the world is nothing but a defense system of belief and perception. That's all we're experiencing right now. We're not really experiencing reality as it is. We're not really aware of it. We're like gone to sleep and dreaming this dream, and it's all defensive in nature, defending arrogance. So we think, make lies true, the world thinks, make lies true, and then we can get rid of all these defense systems that are torturing us constantly, and then we'll be happy. This is how arrogance thinks. What the mind of repentance knows to be true is that this doesn't work. And we have no choice but to set arrogance down and recognize that there are no consequences to setting arrogance down whatsoever. No consequences, other than when we set arrogance down, all the defense systems go with it. But as far as reality, there's no consequences in reality for setting arrogance down. None whatsoever. No annihilation, no punishment, no judgment, nothing. Reality simply realizes, oh, it just is, and it's always just is. It's perfect. Yeah, no consequence of doing it. This is the path of repentance. So when you have those on the path of arrogance, they're unrepentant, their logic is caught up in this defense systems, and they're unable to think properly at all. They just think, we have to maintain these defense systems. We have to stall. We have to delay. We have to keep this going. So their whole thing is just stalling and delaying, stalling and delaying, stalling and delaying, building up more and more defensiveness until lies somehow magically become true. So as if arrogance will somehow magically become true at some point. That's their only hope that they have. So that's their goal. And so they're just... they don't have the ability to follow through with reason on the path of repentance. They're incapable of it. They're so blind. Defenses make you extraordinarily blind to truth. And you don't know what your goal is except to remain confused and stalling. So you hear these people talking, and their whole logic is so scrambled and so confused, and you just feel it. You just say, wow, it's upside down and backwards. And they're furious. They say, well, what are you talking about? This is what works for me. Because they are believing that lies can be made true, and that's how they get freed from these defenses. And so they think by keeping these defenses, that's how they get saved. By keeping the defenses, that's what saves them. So they're bound by the logic of these defenses. They're bound by it. Because again, by keeping these defenses, they believe this stalls and gives enough time for this dream to work out in the way that we think it can work out, which will prove that arrogance is true. And at that point, then arrogance won't need the defenses, because it'll be the new prime creator. And then they will be released from the suffering. Meanwhile, they have to hold on to these defenses. But what these defenses do is bind us and blind us. So our logic is very screwed up and messed up. So here they are, thinking the way to be saved is to hold on to these defenses, which caused them such foolishness in their thinking. Whereas those who are repentant realize that setting down these defenses is the way to salvation. So they are working on setting down these defenses. And when the more they do that, the clearer their reason becomes. And then they're able to see very clearly. And their reason becomes very, very strong and clear. And so in looking at the world, you see these people, unrepentant people, and it's just like, they're like just gibberish, really. I listened to some of them, listening to some clips in the news, and just like, what are you talking about? It's so bizarre. It's upside down and backwards, and nothing you can do with them, because they see that as their salvation, as keeping their reasoning upside down and backwards. They see that as their salvation, and any attempt to straighten it out, they feel is an attack upon them. They take it as an attack. So what you have in this world is this bifurcation of Jesus called it the sheep and the goats. Let's see if we can pull up that parable. Where you have those on the path of repentance, which are called the sheep, and those on the path of arrogance, which are called goats. And that there is going to be some sort of parting of the ways between these two camps, because you simply can't... The sheep and the goats, here you go. Matthew 23:31-46. The more you try to help them, the more they feel they're being attacked, and the more they become defensive. Sheep and the goats are the judgment of the nations. But when the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the holy angels with him, then he will sit on the throne of his glory. Before him all the nations will be gathered, and he will separate them one from another, as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will set the sheep on his right hand, but the goats on his left. Then the king will tell those on his right hand, "Come, blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me drink. I was a stranger, and you took me in. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, and you came to me." Then the righteous will answer him, saying, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, and thirsty and give you a drink? When did we see you as a stranger and take you in, or naked and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and come to you?" The king will answer them, "Most certainly I tell you, because you did it to one of the least of my brothers, brothers, you did it to me. Then he will say also to those on the left hand, depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire, which is prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you didn't give me food to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you didn't take me in. Naked, and you didn't clothe me. Sick, and in prison, you didn't visit me. Then they will also answer, saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or stranger, naked or sick or in prison and didn't help you? Then he will answer them, saying, most certainly I tell you, because you didn't do it to one of the least of these, you didn't do it to me. These will go away into eternal punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. Okay, so this is from, Matthew or something? Anyway, there's some troubles with that, because there is no eternal punishment, no such thing. God doesn't punish anyone, any one of us. God only offers us the grace of salvation. That's it. We punish ourselves with our defensiveness, actually, with our arrogance. Our arrogance is his own punishment, actually. God doesn't need to punish us. Arrogance is his own punishment. Severe punishment, actually. And as far as, you know, feeding and the idea that the idea of works is you were saved through works by taking people in and being nice to them and kind to them. Well, okay. It could also be looked at as in various ways. It's tough to get the, you know, what is Jesus really talking about? And then in A Course in Miracles we find out, well, what was he really saying? And then we say, okay, wow. It's kind of difficult to get from that, from the parables, you know? This is my complaint. So, wow, how in the world could we have gotten this from the parables? You know, very difficult. Parable of the tares. The kingdom of heaven is likened, Jesus is speaking, unto a man which sowed good seed in his field. But while men slept, his enemies came and sowed tares among the wheat and went his way. But when the blade was sprung up and brought forth fruit, then appeared the tares, the weeds. Tares are weeds. Tares also. So the servants of the householder came and said unto him, Sir, didst thou not sow good seed in thy field? And from whence then hath it tares? He said unto them, An enemy hath done this. The servant said unto him, Wilt thou then that we go and gather them up? But he said, Nay, lest while ye gather up the tares, ye root up also the wheat with them. Let both grow together until the harvest, and in the time of harvest I will say to the reapers, Gather ye together first the tares, and bind them in bundles to burn them, but gather the wheat into my barn. Again, so there you go. So this is pretty, you know, it seems pretty obvious now we know in the world what's going on, is don't uproot the wheat, the weeds, because it might uproot the wheat. So let the whole situation keep going until the harvest, which is what's happening. The repentant and the unrepentant are living together in this world right now. But at the harvest time, first the weeds will be uprooted, is what he was saying, and the unrepentant, and put together in bundles and cast into the fire, and then the repentant will be gathered unto the barn. Well, here's another parable. So actually, people can draw all sorts of conclusions from these parables that I feel have contributed quite a bit to various Christian beliefs. Most Christians get their Christianity from the Bible and from these parables, okay? And so they see, oh, the tares are going to be bundled together and thrown into the fire. And they think that, and in the other parable we did before, the parable of the sheep and the goats, that they're going to be cast into this terrible fire and burned, just annihilated by this horrible fire. And so they think, okay, that's what's going to happen. And so you can understand that by listening to these parables, this is what they believe. Now, again, from listening to Jesus' direct teaching, we find out that God doesn't judge anyone at all. Our own arrogance is what judges us. That's the judgment we lay upon ourselves. And that our freedom from this arrogance is its own reward, because then we recognize the perfect love of God, where in arrogance we don't recognize that. And nothing that God created can be destroyed in any way. So there's no way to be eternally, those of you go away into eternal punishment. So eternal punishment for not clothing the, you know, clothing and treating the sick and feeding the hungry and giving water to the thirsty. Eternal punishment is what this parable says. Now, I'm not sure that these are exactly the words of Jesus back at that time, actually, because it does not parallel what Jesus says now. So this is part of the problem the Christians have, is they look at A Course in Miracles and say, wait a minute, this isn't what the parable said. Keep in mind at that time, this was a very much a strifeful time. And the Jews were very much fighting people. And the three revolts against Rome point that out. In fact, Rome finally put the hammer down on them for good, because they were very, very troublesome province. Very much given to insurrection, guerrilla warfare, and that sort of stuff. Very much feisty and fighting, as were most of the people of that time. You know, look at the Syrians. That's what they lived for, actually. They lived just simply to conquest and fight. Conquest was what many people lived for at that time. And they just, you know, slaughter everybody. You know, whatever you see a village, and let's attack it, and let's take over this land and slaughter everybody. And it was dog eat dog, very vicious. And when stuff happens like the final, I think the final destruction of the third revolt of Jerusalem, where it was just absolutely wiped out. I think, you know, they just slaughtered everybody, and which they did, I think, in the second revolt. And you get this. There's so much slaughtering going on in the ancient world that you feel like your enemies, you want them to be destroyed. You want to be forever. You don't want their children. You don't want them to have any children, you know, to take revenge on you. It was so much of a situation of revenge at that time. I mean, they kept grievances, you know, for forever back then. And remember, oh yeah, 500 years ago, you know, you came and slaughtered everyone here. So eventually we'll get our revenge and we'll slaughter all of you. And so they thought in these very strong ways about their enemy. They want their enemies completely annihilated forever. So cast into eternal punishment, you know, those of you who have, you know, bothered us and slaughtered our people, we want you cast into eternal punishment. And this is still completely victim consciousness that they were caught up in. So it's not clear how many of these parables are exactly what Jesus said, actually. Parable of a mustard seed. People know that. The idea of eternal punishment, there is no such thing. The idea of being cast into eternal fire and burning forever, there is no such thing. Our arrogance is the fire that is burning us, actually. We're burning ourselves continuously by believing in victim consciousness, which is the result of our arrogance. Is we have to believe that there's a contest with God, and that we can have a winner and a loser, and that the winner wins and the loser is annihilated. This is where we get this eternal punishment thing. And so we have to believe that this dream of existence is autonomous to us and happens to us. We have to believe that stuff is happening to us beyond our capacity. We're not asking it to happen to us. It's happening to us even though we don't ask for it. This is central to our arrogance. Otherwise, we'd realize that arrogance is non-causative, that we're perfectly free and everything that's happening to us is exactly what we asked for. So we can't see it that way. We have to believe that we don't get what we ask for. In fact, we get stuff. The stuff that happens to us is not what we ask for. This is what we have to believe. So this is called victim consciousness, where we're being victimized by stuff. And so we keep reinforcing in our minds this victim consciousness, often by playing the victim, by suffering. And so this is a big part of the situation. Like they say, you know, you did something terrible to me, and now you deserve eternal punishment for that, because I'm righteous, because I'm a victim, and I didn't, and therefore this empowers me, and my God believes in victim, that I was an unjust victim, and now my God is going to punish you with eternal damnation. This is a lot part of it. The narrative of the mustard seed. Jesus said another parable before them, saying, "The kingdom of heaven is like a grain of mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field, which indeed is smaller than all seeds, but when it is grown, it is greater than the herbs, and becomes a tree." Really? Mustard seed becomes a tree. Okay, "so that the birds of the air come and lodge in its branches." I didn't know that. It must be some kind of strong mustard seed. That's in the Gospel of Matthew. In the Gospel of Mark, it goes like this. Jesus said, "How shall we liken the kingdom of God? Or with what parable will we illustrate it? It's like a grain of mustard seed, which, when it is sown in the earth, though it is less than all the seeds that are on the earth, yet when it is sown, grows up and becomes a greater than all the herbs, and puts out great branches, so that the birds of the sky can lodge under its shadow." I don't know. The Gospel of Luke, it says, he said, "What is the kingdom of God like? To what shall I compare it? It is like a grain of mustard seed, which a man took, put in his own garden. It grew and became a large tree, and the birds of the sky lodged in its branches." Okay, so they talk about it in slightly different ways here. And again, what are we to make of that? I don't know. Parable of the sower. That's another one. Parable of the sower. Text from the Gospel of Mark. From King James. They're using King James. Listen. Behold, there went out a sower to sow. And it came to pass, as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and the birds of the air came and devoured it up. And some fell on stony ground, where it had not much earth, and immediately it sprang up, because it had no depth of earth. But when the sun was up, it was scorched, and because it had no root, it withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it, and it yielded no fruit. And other fell on good ground, did yield fruit that sprang up and increased, and brought forth, some 30, and some 60, some 100. He said unto them, "He that hath ears to hear, let him hear." And now Jesus' explanation given by Jesus in Mark 4, he says, "And when he was alone, they were about him with the 12, asked him of the parable." So the apostles are asking Jesus about this parable. "And he said unto them, Unto you it is given to know the mystery of the kingdom of God, but unto them that are without, all these things are done in parables, that seeing they may see and not perceive, and hearing they may hear and not understand, lest at any time they should be converted, and their sins should be forgiven them. And he said unto them, Know ye this parable? And how then will ye know all parables?" Okay. "The sower soweth the word, and these are they by the wayside where the word is sown, but they have heard. Satan cometh immediately and taketh away the word that was sown in their hearts. And these are they likened which are sown on stony ground, who, when they have heard the word, immediately receive it with gladness, and have no root in themselves, and so endure it but for a time." Very interesting. "Afterward, when affliction or persecution ariseth for the word's sake, immediately they are offended." Okay? "And these are they which are sown among thorns, such as hear the word, and the cares of this world, and the deceitfulness of riches, and the lusts of other things entering in, choke the word, and it becometh unfruitful. And these are they which are sown on good ground, such as hear the word, and receive it, and bring forth fruit, some 30-fold, some 60, and some 100. Okay, so there you go with that. Pretty good, interesting explanation that talking about the teachings of truth, how different ones receive it depending on their the amount of arrogance they still have. And some immediately receive it and say, wow, yeah, that's great, and it's superficial. That's why we practice full stop in the wow. When it builds up to this point, we're just saying, wow, wow, wow. We just quiet then. We don't act it out. It's very important to let the roots sink in. To let the roots sink into us is practicing this full stop in the wow. Very important. We sow the seeds, and we go, wow, you know, this is great. You know, I'm receiving it. Then let go quiet, and let the roots start really growing within you. This is very important. So this parable has a lot to do with the practice that we're practicing. And Jesus' explanation of, he's saying, you know, basically saying that there's some that it's best that their sins not be revealed to them, you know, lest they repent. Like that, it's too much for them. They're not ready to have their sins revealed to them. So he says he speaks in parables so that it will protect those who, you know, in hearing don't hear, they don't understand, they don't get it, seeing they don't see. Meaning that it'll just go right in one ear and out the other. It doesn't reveal their arrogance to them. Basic sin is a sin of spiritual pride. So when he says your sins, is the sin of spiritual pride, which is arrogance, which is desire to be greater than God. Okay, so again, we're continuing to celebrate Jesus' return and just kind of hanging out with that, going over some of the some interesting aspects of his teaching, and I think that was a very interesting one. How? Let me see if I can go back to the pictures here. I'm going to try a little experiment. I don't know if it's going to work here. I kind of doubt it. Are we back at the pictures here? Not really. Yes, we are. Oh, okay. Jesus is knocking here. All right. So, let's see if I can grab this and drag it somehow into this. I don't know if it's going to work. It might work. Okay, let me see. No? Let me try again. No, I don't think it works. Okay. That's all right. I was thinking to spice this up, I can drag some pictures in. And there is some way to do this. I'll do a workaround here. I'll do a workaround. Meanwhile, let us continue on. So I think, I believe it's very important right now to sort of get this sort of relaxed feeling about Jesus and refresh our memory. I think a lot of people have kind of tuned it out, you know, understandably, because all the clamor about interpreting these parables throughout 2,000 years, you know, we've got a headache from it, really. I mean, it's just like after some point you say, oh man, can I not just get a clearer, more direct understanding of all this? I mean, we have to keep slogging away on these parables with, you know, old English and stuff. And so let me try this workaround. That will. And so we've tuned it out. And we kind of need to go back and let us refresh our memory. What is it that why did we tune it out? You know, this is something we can ask ourselves. Why did we tune it out? Oh boy, now it's listing things in a crazy view. Well, I don't understand that. Why did we tune it out? Well, maybe We tuned it out because, you know, these parables just, you know, we felt that we couldn't really get the clear truth from these parables. We were just confused still. And I know that in just, you know, reading, trying to get it from, why isn't this working? Okay, let's try this. Okay, well, that worked. Maybe it directly will work. And reading just a massive amount of interpretations from, okay, this is the sower. This is an artwork of the sower. And reading all these different interpretations, it just drives you crazy. I mean, every Protestant has a different interpretation of it all. I mean, that's one good thing about Catholicism, is basically they say from the Pope on down through the cardinals, bishops, and priests, they say, this is the right interpretation. This is what you tell the faithful. And so you get one version of it. Whereas in Protestantism, everyone has their own interpretation, and it's gotten too much. You know, it just say, wow. There's been, in the last 8 years or so, there's been a 10% drop, or 8% drop in Christianity. People of 8% have turned away from Christianity in the United States. So why have they done that, you see? Well, they just say, wow, I just want some better answers. Okay, better answers. Here's another parable of the sower. A lot of artwork throughout history was, let's see if I can get this to drop straight in. Probably not, because I've tried it before and it doesn't work. Well, that's okay. I'm just going to do it this way then. Ah, it's... Okay. Parable of the sower. So again, let's take a more of a picture. A lot of the last 2,000 years in West Judeo-Christian culture has been artwork having to do about the Bible, many having to do with the parables. Okay, this is also parable of the sower that you're seeing here. Wow, once I get things organized by alphabet that doesn't want to change it. Amazing. Anyway, alphabetically, so the folder's organizing stuff alphabetically. I don't want that, but nothing I can do. The parables in art have consumed, you know, history. And we're struggling to figure out what is Jesus talking about. I mean, we know he's talking about something very important. See, this is, at least we know that, but we say, well, what is it exactly? And you know, the Catholic Church said, listen, folks, we know exactly what Jesus is talking about. We'll tell you. You know, now is that true? No, it's not true. But it's sort of a white lie, in that they say, you know, we can't have everybody. See, the problem is parables are so vague that everybody can have their own interpretation. And they said, look, we can't have everybody having their own interpretation, because it would be chaos then. It would be religious chaos. So they say, in order to you know, prevent that, let's have this, you know, institution where everybody is told, this is what it means. This is what it's all about. And that way everybody feels they're on the same page, you see. And then, but the problem with that is what if the interpretation is not correct? And in going to Catholic Mass for almost 7 years weekly, I can tell you that their interpretations are, you know, way off the mark. They don't know what it means, but they say it with such authority and conviction. There's the priest saying, this is, you know, what the truth is, and that this is what the bishop is telling us it means, and this is what the Pope means, and we all agree. See, what they say is, we all agree that this is what it means. No, that's really not true. What they're saying is, we all agree that it's better we have one interpretation than a whole bunch of interpretations. What was what Protestantism has. You can go to every Protestant church in the land, and they're going to have different. Everyone's going to have a slightly different interpretation, maybe very different interpretation. So they're not really saying that we all agree that this interpretation's right. They're saying we all agree it's better that we all agree upon one interpretation. That's what they're really saying. Okay, do you get that? And they say the end justifies the means, because without that, there'd be chaos. And in some regards, that is factual as far as it goes. That in Protestantism, you just, you know, everyone for themselves, basically. They're all encouraged to read the Bible, make their own interpretations, and figure out the parables. And this has led to, you know, you just a lot of talking back and forth, talk. And then people say, my gosh, I just hope the world ends soon, because we're just this, all of this confusion is driving us crazy. What else? The parable of the barren fig tree. That's a barren fig tree parable. Okay. So we're just cruising along, kind of bringing some historical perspective. Jesus has returned, and we need to get some historical perspective on the whole thing here. And I'm just doing that in a kind-hearted, loving way, not mean-spirited. I know everyone's going to be saved. Okay, so this is my perspective, that everyone is absolutely going to be saved. So I look at everybody as my equal in spirit, and I know that one day they will absolutely realize their perfect freedom in truth, and be all empowered, as we all will be all empowered. So what we're just talking about context here and clarification here. We're not judging or punishing anybody here. This is a parable of the barren fig tree. We're not suggesting anyone be punished. We just need to get perspective right now. It's time for perspective. Parable of the barren fig tree. Jesus spoke also of this parable. A certain man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came and sought the fruit thereon, and found none. Then said he unto the dresser of his vineyard, Behold, these 3 years I have come seeking fruit on this fig tree, and find none. Cut it down. Why cumbereth it the ground? Whatever that means. Why is it even in the ground? And he answering said unto him, Lord, let it alone this year also, till I shall dig about it, and dung it, or fertilize it. And if it bear fruit, well. I mean, good. And if not, then after that, thou shalt cut it down. Oh, man. In this parable, the owner is generally regarded as representing God, who had a fig tree, planted his vineyard, and the gardener didn't do a good job, and on and on and on. Parable is also be connected with this and this. So here he goes, interpretation, right? And on and on and on and I go, and I don't know exactly how to interpret that. You know, and this is bothersome. You say, hey, you know, how does reason, you know, interpret that exactly? Difficult to say. It you know, for me, I would say, well, it could very well mean that this is the mood of arrogance, that it bears no fruit. You know, this is how I would just off, you know, just looking at it, I'd say, well, this probably means that the parable of the barren fig, this one has fruit actually on it, that arrogance bears no fruit. Okay, the idea that arrogance can succeed in bringing us happiness isn't true. It never does. It never bears fruit. And yet, our belief in arrogance always says, hey, wait a little longer. It's going to bear fruit next year, so to speak. Okay, this is how I see it. So when Jesus tells us, hey, you know, cut down the tree of arrogance, meaning repent and set down arrogance, we say, no, Jesus, not yet. Wait a little longer, and it's going to bear fruit. Next year it'll bear fruit. And this is how we keep deceiving ourselves. So you see, my reason will look at it very differently than all these theologians and scholars and et cetera have looked at it. Very, very differently. I look at it from the perspective I just explained. That our trouble is our sheer arrogance, trying to be greater than God, our spiritual pride. It bears no fruit whatsoever. Bears no fruit whatsoever. And Jesus said, Why did you put it in the ground? It's not doing you any good whatsoever. Why did you ever pick up this silly whim of wanting to be greater than God? It doesn't bear you any happiness, satisfaction, or joy, glory at all. And instead of saying, you know what, Jesus, you're right. I'll take it out of the I'll cut it down and take it out of the ground because it bears no fruit. It's barren. Arrogance. Our arrogance is barren fruit, barren tree, but no fruit. Instead, we say, hey, Jesus, you know, yeah, it hasn't borne fruit yet, but next year, bumper crop, it's going to succeed, right? This is how I see it. So if I really went through the parables, I might be able to interpret, you know, a lot of them, but I don't want to bother, you know, the Christians too much that have, you know, be too direct, because this is sort of their safety net where they can kind of look at it any which, all different sort of ways, and think that this might be like this or might be like that. But it might be worth considering that this interpretation of this parable of the barren fig tree. So, see, we're cruising along here. I got it kind of working, right? If you just, you know, bear with me here. Sometimes, you know, not sometimes, usually I you know, manage to get it going here. What else do we want to look at? These are some good ones that we've had. The pearl. Let's look at the pearl. The pearl of great price. I think this is one. Yeah. Now, refresher course here, folks. We're just. I've forgotten about a lot of this stuff. I mean, I've. You know, this is going back over the last several thousand years. What has Western culture been involved with the last several thousand years? Well, we've been involved with this. Here, parable of the fig tree. I don't know why they use the King James version. This is Wikipedia. I mean, this is very strange. I mean, there's a lot of versions that have put it into modern English, and to use King James version makes it seem very cumbersome, actually. And I sort of feel like, are they doing this on purpose to make, you know, the teaching seem odd and bizarre to us? You know, is that why they're using King James? I mean, there's so many other versions that have it laid out in much clearer language, but they choose the King James. Strange. Who made that decision on Wikipedia? Okay, parable of the pearl. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant man seeking goodly pearls, okay, who, when he had found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. All right, once again, Jesus is speaking. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant man seeking goodly pearls, who, when he had found one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. Okay, parable of the pearls. Is there any artwork associated with this? Not really. Here's one. I can give you this one. Okay, well, this is pretty straightforward, I would say. When you find truth, you realize all the lies, all the nice looking lies, aren't worth anything to you, and you decide, I don't need any of those. I'm gonna go with this. Go with the truth. Go with the truth. It's like Jesus himself. You find a teacher who is teaching you truth consciousness. You know, why would you want to cling then to lie consciousness or victim consciousness? Why cling to victim consciousness when you find a teacher that teaches truth consciousness? Cling to that. Say, hey, let me throw away all these books that. And actually, I mean, the perfect example is when I found A Course in Miracles. I didn't really need to read other books at that point. You know, I said, wow, I'm not going to waste my time reading other books. I'd read a massive amount of books actually by that time, and I said, let me focus on this book. And likewise, when I found Journey Beyond Words, I said, let me just focus on this book. I don't need any other books, because this one has it all. This one really is clear. Why spend your time with stuff that's confusing when you have something that's very clear? This is what the parable's getting at. You know, the clear truth, when you find the clear truth, don't waste your time with all the cumbersome, unclear truths, which you might say when I found A Course in Miracles, I said, wow, this is direct teaching. Why should I struggle with all these parables when I have the direct teaching here? Okay? And that's, so I stopped struggling with the parables. I stopped struggling with the Bible because I said, oh, this is the direct teaching now that we have. And this is the pearl of great price, right? The pearl of great price. So just put all your attention onto the pearl of great price and take your attention off of all the other stuff. Don't divide your attention among many aspects of confusion. Put all your attention on that which is clear. Put all your attention on that which is clear. And don't try to divide it up, saying, well, I'm going to get more result by paying attention to, you know, 1,000 confusing books. Say, no, I'm going to get more results by putting all my attention on one clear book, clear teaching. Okay, parable of the net. Jesus said, again, the kingdom of heaven is like a dragnet that was cast into the sea and gathered some fish of every kind, which when it was filled, they drew up on the beach. They sat down and gathered the good into containers, but the bad they threw away. So will it be in the end of the world. The angels will come forth and separate the wicked from among the righteous and will cast them into the furnace of fire. There you go, there's the fire again. There will be the weeping and the gnashing of teeth. Jesus said to them, have you understood all these things? They answered him, yes, Lord. He said to them, therefore, every scribe who has been made a disciple in the kingdom of heaven is like a man who is a householder who brings out of his treasure new and old things. Okay. So interesting. It's hard to say what. Well, I mean, there again, you're talking about the separation of the sheep and the goats, of the repentant and the unrepentant. And there again, they use the fire that they be cast into the wicked will be cast into the furnace of fire. Well, it could be that the world will actually undergo a sort of cosmic fire of high energy particles that may fry the earth. That is possible. Those that stay in the world will be burnt by a cosmic fire. It's possible that maybe the sun will become too hot here, and that's possible. So I don't know exactly what the purpose of talking about that is. It really, but from a theological standpoint, that's not possible in terms of God doesn't punish anyone. So again, our own arrogance is what punishes us. This is the parable of the net. Yeah, most artwork throughout the ages has been religious artwork. That was the only topic that was considered suitable because people didn't know how to read, and so art was a type of communication. Most people didn't know how to read, and art communicated these teachings to people, and it was so very, very important. What else do we have here? So this is pretty interesting. Faithful servant. Have we gone into the faithful servant one? This is an eschatological parable talking about the end of the world. There's a number of those. 10 virgins is one. Great banquet, rich fuel, wicked husbandman, tares, the net, budding of the fig tree, barren fig tree. These are about the end of the world. And Jesus was big on the end of the world. At least it's taught that he was, you know, very much spoke about that and emphasized it, saying you better prepare for the end of this world. So do we have it up there? This is there you go. This is the parable of the faithful servant. Parable of the faithful servant. In Luke, the parable is as follows. Sort of a long one here, so bear with us here. This Jesus is speaking, let your waist be dressed and your lamps burning. Be like men watching for their Lord when he returns from the marriage feast, that when he comes and knocks, they may immediately open to him. Blessed are those servants whom the Lord will find watching when he comes. Most certainly I tell you that he will dress himself and make them recline, and he will come and serve them. Wow. I put that wow in there. They will be blessed if he comes in the second or third watch and finds them so. But know this, that if the master of the house had known in what hour the thief was coming, he would have watched and not allowed his house to be broken into. Therefore, be ready also, for the Son of Man is coming in an hour that you don't expect him. Jesus is speaking of himself. He referred to himself as the Son of Man. Peter said to him, Lord, are you telling this parable to us or to everybody? The Lord said, who then is the faithful and wise steward whom his Lord will set over his household to give them their portion of food at the right times? Blessed is that servant whom his Lord will find doing so when he comes. Truly I tell you that he will set him over all that he has. But if that servant says in his heart, my Lord delays his coming, and begins to beat the men servants and the maid servants, and to eat and drink and to be drunken, then the Lord of that servant will come in a day when he isn't expecting him, and an hour that he doesn't know, and he will cut him in two and place his portion with the unfaithful. That servant who knew his Lord's will and didn't prepare nor do what he wanted will be beaten with many stripes, but he who didn't know and did things worthy of stripes will be beaten with few stripes. To whomever much is given, of him will much be required, and to him much was entrusted, of him more will be asked. So when the answer to Peter's question is that those who are given the truth to share with others, more is required of them. And if they fail to do this, more regret will accompany it. And they use very colorful, beaten and cut in two and stuff. Because back then, I mean, it was nasty back then. In the third insurrection, a Jewish revolt against Rome, they surrounded Jerusalem with a huge wall, so nobody could escape. The Romans built this wall, and then anybody going down into the valley, going over the walls of Jerusalem and down into a valley and trying to escape, they'd capture them, and they'd crucify them and put them up along the wall facing Jerusalem, so everybody could see what would happen to anyone trying to escape. And they said like up to 500 people a day were being crucified. You know, I mean, it's just, they were brutal back then. So you're saying whipped with stripes and stuff. That was nothing back then to be whipped and cut in two and all this kind of stuff. So you have to understand the brutality of the time was just off the charts. Anyway, this is a very, very nice parable, which is seems pretty straightforward. Is Jesus is saying his return will come at a time you don't expect it. And to the ones that have prepared for the return, and did what he said to prepare, and he said they'll be very blessed, when the Lord finds them watching, he says, I tell you, he will dress himself, make them recline, and he will come and serve them. And he talks about they'll have everything that Jesus has, so Jesus will be very pleased by those who are watching for his return and have prepared for it, which is what we are doing here. But those who are drunk and said, "What the heck? You know, we're not going to keep watching. We're not going to keep preparing, beating the servants and eating and drinking and you know, indulging in sensuality in the flesh and all that." They will be very displeased about that. But really, it means that their own arrogance will really roast them with the defensiveness that arrogance brings. Jesus himself isn't going to beat them. No, it's not like that. Okay, so how are we doing here? I'm hoping to get more time on this by putting in these pictures, but I don't feel I'm really getting that. Interesting. It's not really working the way I hoped it would. 1.5 hours, 1.5, I've got, that's 3. Well, it is sort of. I can get about 3 hours by the way it's going on this, so. Parable, so this is a very famous parable. Parable of the faithful servant, which Jesus is basically telling us, you know, to watch for his return. Absolutely be faithful in watching for his return. And if you are, it's going to go very good for you. And his return has already happened. And so, but part of the return is our own recognition of it. It's very important. And we will find out very soon what's going to take place. So back to the parables we go. Back to the parables we go. Eschatological parables, the ones about the end of the world. We've gone over a lot of these already, right? The net, budding fig tree, barren fig tree, the tares, the 10 virgins and the faithful servant. So we've gone over, so here, the rich fool. Let's go over the rich fool. This is also an eschatological end time parable. Only appears in Luke, this one. Okay. An audience member that Jesus was speaking to tries to enlist Jesus' help in a family financial dispute, and Jesus, one of the multitudes, said to him, "Teacher, tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me." But he said to him, "Man, who made me a judge, man who made me a judge or an arbiter over you?" Jesus said to them, "Beware. Keep yourselves from covetousness, for a man's life doesn't consist of the abundance of the things which he possesses." Jesus then responds with the parable. Jesus spoke a parable to them, saying, "The ground of a certain rich man brought forth abundantly. He reasoned within himself, saying, 'What will I do? Because I don't have room to store my crops.' He said, 'This is what I will do. I will pull down my barns and build bigger ones, and there I will store all my grain and my goods. I will tell my soul, "Soul, you have many goods laid up for many years. Take your ease, eat, drink, be merry." But God said to him, "You foolish one, tonight your soul is required of you. The things which you have prepared, whose will they be? So is he who lays up treasure for himself and is not rich towards God." Okay, there you go. That's the parable of the rich fool, which we will take a look at. The parable of the rich fool. So first Jesus has asked, you know, decided the inheritance, and Jesus says, "Hey, don't be so bothered about the abundance of things that you possess. Don't be too obsessed by that. It's not that important." And then the parable of the rich fool is the rich fool said, "Hey, if I just, you know, able to store all the abundance that's possible I can get, then I can take it easy." And Jesus says, you know, "Tonight your soul is required of you." I mean, the moment of choice is here now. If that was the case, are you prepared? Have you prepared? So don't lay up your treasures for yourself. Lay them up towards God. Be rich towards God. In other words, don't spend all your time trying to build a bigger barn to lay up everything that you can possibly get in this world. Spend time becoming repentant. Spend time on repentance. This is what Jesus, I see, this is what Jesus is saying. And here's some artwork for the parable of the foolish rich man. And I feel, you know, I've been able to follow this, is I don't have many goods or possessions. Why did it do this? I don't know. It just zapped back to me and not on the picture. That's funny. You never know what a computer's going to do, do you? Not at all. And I spent my time on, you know, clarification and repentance instead of trying to get rich, which is, I guess, it turns out to be a good decision. Now that Jesus is back, I can say, wow, I at least I spent my time wisely. I don't know how repentant I am, but at least I gave it a good, very good run, that is for sure. I know, you know, it's not like I'm saying, hey, Jesus, look at this really great mansion I have, and look at all the cars I have. I mean, I know people that have, you know, 20 cars. They have a garage. They have a basement with a huge, you know, basement with a turntable in their basement. And all the cars are positioned on this turntable, and it turns. And when it gets to the one where the entrance to the garage is, then you can drive it out. You see, and so they just store all these cars in their garage, all these fancy cars, they have mansions, and they have all this stuff. They have this enormous accumulation of this stuff in warehouses, you know, just, but they, I don't know if they can say a word of truth. I don't know if they're familiar with even a word of truth. And for some reason, this ability to show pictures has disappeared. So who is more prepared? You know, who is more prepared now that Jesus is back? Okay, what are they going to say to Jesus? They're going to say, hey, look at all the cars I have, Jesus. You want to take a ride? And Jesus says, no, not really. That's not really. Thanks, but not necessary. Well, look at my house. Do you want to come in and look at all the rooms I have? And let me give you a tour of, here's the rec room, and here's the living room, and here's the high beam ceiling, and here's this, and here's the swimming pool, and here's the tennis courts, and, you know, look at our lawn, and here's the landscaping. And Jesus will say, what about repentance? What about your repentance? What about letting go of your defense systems, which are torturing you? The defense of arrogance, what about those? And says, huh? No. As soon as we make lies true, then all the defenses will be gone, and I'll have all this stuff, and I'll be really, really happy. You know, well, Jesus, are you happy now? No. It's really a burden, all this stuff, but I know I'm going to be happy soon, as soon as lies become true. And then Jesus will say, yeah, you know, that's not where it's at. Wow, this evening has just suddenly gotten cool, cloudy and cool, and cannot display these pictures. Never know what is going to happen here. Oh well. No, it's not really working at all. Amazing. Maybe if I throw another picture in there, that will, like, trigger it or something. Let me throw this one. This is, throw this one in there, which is one we've seen before. Maybe this one will even accept it or not. Not really. So it's not even accepting pictures now. Oh well. So that's our little art lesson, you know, our cultural lesson for this this time, unless I can get it to work. That we've gone through these parables and seen some, you know, some historical context to it all. And full stop in the wow. Right now we're kind of like saying, wow, this is a lot to cover. Well, it's a good time to go over this stuff. I cannot get it to behave here. Let me see if I can. Nothing is coming up. Interesting. Well, the software has just become very unresponsive, so we'll just carry on here. Or not. I don't know. I'm starting to get cold. That's for sure. I thought I had enough here, but what's the matter, California? You know, I thought it was supposed to be perfect weather. We get very upset when it's not perfect, because we just expect not to be inconvenienced by the weather here. You know, we really expect it. So when we're inconvenienced, we say, well, what is this? What is this? I thought we'd left that behind. I thought we'd found paradise here. Not exactly. But what kind of paradise is it when you know, many of your fellow spirits are mired in the defensiveness of arrogance, and really you can't even have a conversation with them? It's impossible. I mean, I don't know anybody I can have a conversation with around this area. I don't really know anyone. I haven't known anyone basically my whole life I can have a conversation with, because it immediately bogs down into defensiveness. Because as soon as you start bringing up clarity, they panic. They panic. And they say, I'm going to be annihilated if I look at this. What are you doing? This is crazy. Let's go back down and talk about the crime rate and terrible things. And they immediately, this is what I experience, is people, when they're around me, they immediately try to go back to something that really scares them real bad that they can deal with, like crime. And yeah, they start focusing on that. And it's like, wow, you know, they can't keep their mind on clarity, because they think they're going to be annihilated if they look at this. So they project this fear of annihilation out into a world which is something that they feel they can at least control somehow, which is crime, and then talk about that. You know, they displace it instead of just looking at annihilation just as it is, as a belief that we have, a false belief. You know, they can't do that. They're not able to do it. So it's like an impossible to have a conversation. And basically, I talk about the weather and sports. You know, that's why I talk about sports a lot, because that's the only way I can relate with people. Otherwise, they tune out and immediately project their fear and start, you know, the whole conversation just goes nowhere, just stops. Maybe will this work? I don't know. Please work. Please work. No, you're not going to work, are you? Okay, this is what I've experienced. So thank you to those of you who watch the videos and comment, that obviously you're able to hold a conversation to some extent about all of this. There's not too many of us in the world, actually. Doesn't seem that way, does it? Which is really amazing, very sad. Now, apropos of Jesus, you know, to be a friend with Jesus means you can hold a conversation. I mean, what kind of friends can't hold a conversation with one another? For instance, if I was talking with someone about, like, for instance, golf or something, I'd be able to hold a conversation with any golfer. I can do that for sure. And we feel like, you know, some friendship there. We feel that we're able to converse about something we really love. Well, yeah. I don't love it that much anymore. Golf is actually quite difficult. It's really quite kind of brutal in a lot of ways, unless you're on a really, really nice course and a beautiful day and just having fun. It can get very, very difficult and frustrating. And when you're playing on courses that have canyons and mountains, and, you know, it can be really very not so much fun at all. I've learned that, and not having played now for quite some time, I'm looking back and watching golfers and saying, oh man, aren't I glad that I don't have to struggle with this, you know, the ball's in some weeds, it's in some deep grass, you know, it's just tough. Anyway, wanting to converse with Jesus, we need to be able to converse with him, to be his friend, right? How can we have a relationship of friendship unless we're able to converse about what we love? What do we love? The truth. What do we love? Freedom. What do we love? Setting down arrogance and accepting the pure love of God. The freedom. Truth. We love clarity. We love recognizing that we're not a body. We've never been a body, as a matter of fact. I've never been a body. I've always been free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I've never been a body. I've always been free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Let me see. Can I... Any way to... I've never been a body. I've always been free. This is a fact right now. Right now I'm not a body. Okay? This is a mere appearance in the now. What we call body is mere appearance than now. It has no continuity to it whatsoever. And no inherent continuity to it whatsoever, actually. Not really. We have this profound illusion that it does, but it doesn't really. The very next instant, this body could turn into the sky, for instance, or a ball of light, or whatever. This is a mere appearance. And the next moment is not bound to this moment. In a process time-space process of form doesn't really exist at all. So I've never been a body. At no point in time is anyone a body. Can I go into advanced settings? Will this do anything? This will probably ruin everything. Anytime you click on something, it seems like it can ruin everything here on computers. Well, it just doesn't want to cooperate at all here. Nope, doesn't want to cooperate. Well, that's part of the situation here in this world, isn't it? Can I get something here? I guess Holy Spirit says, enough of the parables. Done enough. Stop it. Fine, we stopped it. It's been stopped for us. So now, a lot of Christians think that when Jesus returns, that they somehow have to explain the parables to Jesus in order to hang out with Jesus. That they will be able to have to sit with Jesus and say, okay, Jesus, this parable, now I know exactly what you meant. And if they can't tell him exactly what he meant, they think they're going to be cast into the fire. So they're very scared about that. You know, that somehow, that righteousness means being able to understand these parables, okay? So you can understand how most Christians say, sure, we want Jesus to return, and we're all for that, but we're just not quite ready for Jesus to return. So in hearing here that Jesus has returned, I think a lot of them will say, no, not yet, because they don't understand the parables yet. You see how this works? I don't even understand the parables. I might be able to get a few of them right, but others I just shake my head and say, I'm not sure what you're talking about exactly. So does that mean like I'm going to be annihilated, that I can't relate with Jesus? Okay, so this is very important. And let us go over this. That since this is the teaching that they say that Jesus gave out, and you talk about, you know, at the end will be judged, the wheat and the tares, and it will be, you know, divided. The sheep and the goats will be divided. The bad ones will cast into the eternal fire, eternal punishment. So we think that to be good, to be seen good by God, we have to understand what Jesus taught us. And in order to do this, we have to understand these parables. So we think we have to be able to definitively say, this is what this parable means. I understand it. And then we think in order to be friends with Jesus, which is what he calls us to, we have to be able to sit with Jesus and say, Jesus, I know exactly what this parable means. And then explain it to him. But deep down, we realize that we're not sure. We don't really know. We're not sure about what these parables mean. And so obviously then we say, wait a minute, Jesus, don't come back yet, because I haven't quite figured it out yet. I'm still trying, I'm still struggling. But keep in mind, these parables are given out to those who are incapable of understanding the direct truth. So it'd give them all sorts of wiggle room so their sins would not be made immediately apparent to them. In other words, their arrogance wouldn't become directly obvious to them and freak them out, you know, really freak them out. Which it would do so. It would freak them out. So it's not meant to that you're supposed to get it, necessarily exactly get it. That you're sort of progressively, gradually, you start building some wisdom. So, but then Jesus said, later I'm going to give you direct teaching. Okay, I'm giving you direct teaching. And so when you get the direct teaching, then it's much easier to understand what Jesus is saying. So that now that Jesus is here, and you say, well, okay, I want to relate with Jesus. He's here to relate to us as friends. We can sit beside Jesus and say, Jesus, yeah, I know what you're teaching us about. It's easy. It's simple. And you can say that, and you can converse. You can converse about it. And you're not afraid, you know, you're going to be cast into the furnace and annihilated and burned forever. There's no such fear. I don't have that fear at all. So we can understand how someone like myself would be able to recognize that Jesus has returned, and not because I'm not frightened by it. I'm not saying, hey, wait a minute, wait a little longer, Jesus. I don't quite understand your parables yet, because I haven't been struggling with the parables. I've been studying Jesus' direct teaching. And for instance, you know, Journey Beyond Words, for instance. And I kind of understand that pretty well. and agree with it, and is not all this confusion. So I don't have any fear. I said, Jesus wants to come now, fine. I'm ready. I can converse with Jesus, no problem. Jesus isn't going to throw some parable at me and say, explain that to me, you know, like some test. And I'd say, why are you speaking? I'd say, why are you speaking in parables? I'd speak directly to me. I don't have any problem with that. And Jesus, you know, would say something like, well, you got to choose between victim consciousness and truth consciousness. And I'd say, absolutely, let's talk about that. And, you know, wonderful, easy, no problem. So I think most Christians, the Christians I've encountered, they all say, yes, we believe Jesus is returning, okay? And they also all say he's not coming yet. They usually say, well, about 5 years out of what I've experienced in my life. They say, yeah, I think it's about 5 years from now he might return. And they all seem to have this, you know, few years, 5 years, you know, not tomorrow. Tomorrow? No, not tomorrow. He's still, many things have to happen in the world. You know, they always say that. Many things have to happen in the world. Still, this hasn't happened. Only when these things happen will he come back. And so they're always pushing it further, because they're afraid. Plain and simple, they don't understand the parables. You're like, I'm saying, reassuring everybody, who does? I get some of them. And other ones, there's like, well, wow, you know, this is kind of maybe, you know, this is Luke's understanding of it, or Matthew or Mark's understanding of the parable, or this is the parables that's will put this way so it'll placate the Romans. I mean, the Romans are very upset with the Jews. Let's keep this in mind after. Actually, in 70 A.D., about 36, 7 years or so after Jesus passed away, I don't know what Jesus' age was exactly, if he was born in 4 B.C., which is likely because Herod the Great was still alive then and passed away in 4 B.C., and we're told Jesus was born in the time of Herod the Great, and then John the Baptist started preaching in A.D. 29, and then Jesus' ministry is about 3 years since from that point when he was baptized by John the Baptist. Maybe he's baptized, let's say, well, he would have been 33 when John the Baptist baptized him, actually, and 3 more years would mean make 36. So 36 and 34 would bring us to 70 AD when they had the first Jewish revolt, big time revolt, and against the attack, the Roman rule over Judea. And this brutal Titus, this is when Titus destroyed Jerusalem, tore down the temple, the second temple, cut down all the trees and wiped out all vegetation in the suburbs. Jerusalem was beautiful, beautiful, beautiful city with leafy suburbs, you know, so nice. And afterwards they said nobody could recognize anything hardly had ever stood there. It was like a desert. Absolutely, Titus absolutely desolated because the Jews were, you know, very vicious, towards the Romans, trying to, you know, cost them tremendous losses, actually, in this war. And so there was no mercy spared. They absolutely, Augustus, I think it was Augustus at the time, Caesar said, destroy the city, the temple. We don't want any more problems with Jerusalem. And then there was a second revolt, a guerrilla warfare at some time by the people from Galilee actually revolted, guerrilla warfare in Galilee. And then there was the Bar Kokhba revolt in what was it, 130 blah blah 7 or something. I could pull it up here, but it was the very bad, again, revolt cost the Romans dearly. So the Romans, they suffered severe losses in these wars with the Jews. And they were very upset with the Jews. And so the attitude that the Romans had towards the Jews was a very bad one. And they basically, you know, sold during the after the first revolt, the diaspora began, and they tried to catch the Jews, sold them into slavery, dispersed them. I mean, they just tried to get rid of the Jews entirely. No, they're not giving me this. And after the final third revolt, there were hardly any more Jews left in the whole province. I mean, they really just tried to wipe them out completely. So the early Christians had, many of them were Jews, okay? Many of them were Jews. And they faced the situation of the hatred of the Romans for the Jews. So it's very likely that they tried to make Christianity into something more palatable to the Romans, trying to say, hey, look, we're not like those Jews. And I think in the third final revolt, I know the Christians in Galilee did not participate, did not help the revolt, and they were severely persecuted by the Jews for not helping them out, actually. So it's very possible that the Gospels, as we know them, were put in such a way as to be very favorable to Rome, the Roman Empire, and not so favorable to the Jews. Okay, try to differentiate. There's a very strong attempt to differentiate themselves from the Jewish religion, that is for sure. Now, how much role that played, I don't know. Wikipedia has this problem, whereas if you don't give exactly, type what you're, properly what you're asking for, they play dumb. That page does not exist. I mean, at least Google, when you use it, it says, do you mean this? You know, is this what you mean? and then you say, oh yeah, that's what I meant. Oops, let's see, bars, okay. Yeah, absolutely. So, see, Google is able to give you all these choices. Is this what you're talking about? But Wikipedia is very poor at that. Their capacity to do that is atrocious. So if you don't know exactly how to type it in, you know, it just plays dumb on you. Yeah. So keep in mind this context of Christianity. Was Christianity, you know, in order to survive, had to play nice with the Romans, for sure. And they did to a certain extent. Now, how this shaped the Bible and how that shaped Christianity is something that, you know, theologians love to talk about. Theological historians, and they said, you know, it could have been this, it could have been this way, it could have, and we're not sure exactly how much it shaped it all, but I suspect that it played a role. There's a lot of different influences. There could have been a lot of different influences. Wow. No data received. This is getting. So it's great to have the modern teaching of Jesus where it's not been subjected to all these influences. A Course in Miracles seems like it's pretty straightforward, very straightforward. And I get the feeling that this is Jesus speaking very directly, and his meaning is being conveyed pretty well. Now, Jesus, I believe, sort of has intimated that even with this, that the scribe, Helen Schuckman, had her issues, as we all do, okay? This is not a judgment on Helen Schuckman. We all have our issues as far as our arrogance is concerned. We have, none of us, as far as I know, have repented completely, at least very few of us. So, you know, she had her issues, and Jesus said he had to work around them, which is understandable. So, you know, when I read A Course in Miracles, it still is tinged with arrogance and interpretation. it's not, I don't feel it's exactly, you know, directly how Jesus would speak to us if we were to relate with him right now, which we may be able to do at some point, actually pretty soon. I mean, even today we probably could. He's back. Let me see. I'm trying to see if I can bring anything into the video. Cannot. It's really not picking up any. That's too bad. I wish it would. So even with A Course in Miracles, I feel it's. And there's different versions of A Course in Miracles, actually, that some were edited more than others. The original ones, the version tended to have a lot of personal information for William Helen Schuckman and William Tedford talking about their own, you know, neuroses and troubles and what was causing them so much trouble and stuff like that. Jesus related to them very personally. And in the later versions, that was edited out. But you know, most of it remains the same, actually. There's just a few little punctuation and things, but the personal information was edited out. And I find in some of the talk about psychoanalysis and what Jesus is talking about, I find it fine that information was edited out. I don't find it, you know, that important, really. It was more like just personal stuff. It doesn't bother me that it was edited out. Now, in Journey Beyond Words by Dr. Brent Haskell, which was published, I think, in 1994, I find that this is closer to what Jesus is really conveying, that Dr. Haskell was able to accept a clearer picture than Helen Schuckman, actually. But the Course in Miracles was necessary first in order to get to a more direct approach. We wouldn't have been ready for this direct approach had it not come first. And Helen Schuckman was willing to take down in shorthand all this massive amount of writing and dedicate her life to this, along with William Tedford. Let me see. And I'm forgetting someone, of course, who also, Kenneth Wapniak? Is that what his name? Yeah. Who also, he helped with the final version and I think helping take out all the personal stuff. Kenneth Wapniak or something. His name always is a tough one for me. Which he unfortunately passed on. Well, maybe fortunate for him, he passed on several years ago or something. I'm not sure. I'm trying to get the internet to work and it's not working. Oh well, so what? We continue on. So, Journey Beyond Words, I feel, is clearer Jesus than other stuff. It's clearer, where he's speaking more directly. Like, this is what I really directly, you know, want to say, even more clearly than A Course in Miracles. And I believe he can be even clearer than that. And Dr. Brent Haskell, I feel there's a little, you know, of course, there again, you have some quote unquote bias that shapes it a little bit, shapes it in some ways. He has his own outlook, own perspective also. So Jesus had to shape it in a certain way, but it seems like very little. It seems like Jesus really shaped it the way he wanted to there. And Dr. Haskell was able to get out of the way to an amazing extent, actually. I think it was just truly astonishing how much he was able to get out of the way and still function in this world as a doctor. I don't know how he did it. Here we go. Okay, so finally the Wikipedia page is there. And if I had... I got it right. Kenneth Wapniak. Almost right. Helped edit the book. Yeah. And then you have example of Christianity rejecting it. Father Benedict Groschel, eventually he said that he kind of got went negative on it. And they talked about Helen Schuckman later rejecting it and stuff like this because, well, you know, she was tired of, it was a great effort on her part. And I think she would just said, look, I did what I came here to do, and let others deal with the other aspects of it. Don't make an idol out of me, you know. And it was too much for her, really. I mean, it bothered her a great deal later in life, because people thought that, you know, hey, you know, you have the answer, you know the answers, tell us the truth, you're the one that Jesus spoke with, you know. And she said, I was a scribe, I took it down, I got the book out for you, now it's up to you to study it and make the best of it you can. Don't, you know, I'm someone who just had the capacity to do this, I was willing to do it. That doesn't mean that I have, you know, I'm free from all arrogance, far from it. Don't expect that of me. So she basically said, stay away. I don't want to be famous and associated with this in terms of, you know, going forward with this. I mean, it's very understandable. But Father Groschel uses this as to say, look, you see, Helen rejected it. And so Christianity should reject it too. It doesn't teach what's in the Bible, which as we know now, are all these parables, which are open. And Jesus plainly said, I use these parables so that those who can hear cannot hear it. In other words, those who are not ready can't understand what I'm talking about, so that their sins will not be revealed unto them. We went over this earlier. Because it'll freak them out. Jesus plainly is telling us that we weren't ready to see directly. It would freak us out. And I, having my own experience, I agree entirely with that. That it we're so scared of what we'll see behind our defenses, something awful, which, you know, an abyss of annihilation, which is what we feel is the loser gets in this contest we're having with God. To make the contest seem plausible, we have to have, you know, a winner and a loser. And we have to make it seem like our arrogance has to win. And the loser, therefore, God, perfection, has to be annihilated, because we say that, no, reality isn't the way that you said. It's not all one God. Therefore, you know, that vanishes. The oneness of God's reality has to vanish. Annihilation. So we're terrified of it. Terrified of this. And so Jesus is basically saying, look, those who are not ready, they won't understand what I'm saying. So a lot of Christianity is those who are not so ready, and they're thinking, well, I need to at least be able to repeat this, to parrot, you know, what Jesus said, and so I parrot it, and I think that's good enough, but they don't really understand what Jesus is saying. So when you get something very direct like this, it freaks them out. They say, whoa, you know, we're not ready for this, and this isn't Christianity that I understand the way it's supposed to be. So we you know, also in the parable of the new wine, old wine, Jesus said, you know, you put new wine in old wineskins, you know, it's going to burst them. Are they going to say, I prefer the old wine? So Father Groschel said, I prefer the old wine. And said, Helen Schuckman rejected it. And this stuff. No, she didn't reject it. She just said, I'm fed up. I've had enough. Understandable. Very understandable. Let others carry forward this mission that is, you know, unfolding as we speak. So I feel I'm part of that further unfolding of this. Jesus' mission is a return. So I'm able to, you know, deal with what I'm able to deal with. And it's all part of it. And those, the old guard, like, you know, William Tedford and Kenneth Wapnick, are no longer here, unfortunately, but they did, you know, their thing. That was what they came to do, and they did a fantastic, great job, well done, faithful servant, that is for sure. That they brought Jesus' direct teaching to light, so those who were going to relate with Jesus when they returned would be able to, you know, get up to speed. And that's where we're at now. And that's where I'm at. That's my purpose, is to, you know, relate with Jesus. Be able to do that as a friend. Communicate. Let's communicate. Let's talk about it. What is simple, you know? Truth consciousness is true and victim consciousness is not true. And this world is certainly being separated now in two directions, either going with victim consciousness or truth consciousness. And basically what they're doing, they're making heroes out of those who play the role of victim in this world, aren't they? Absolutely they are. If you've been victimized, then you're good. You're righteous. And the ones who supposedly did the victimizing, they're evil. They need to be destroyed. You know, that kind of thing. It's just unbelievable how victim consciousness, how they twist and distort the facts of anything. And we're seeing this happening right in front of our eyes, this drama that's taking place. And, you know, especially involving, you know, the police and those who are, you know, getting in trouble with the police. And this is what they're saying. They're trying to work, they're working on this victimization thing. And they're trying to get it the way they want it to be so that criminals are righteous, then they're victims of the police, and they should be seen as the righteous ones. I mean, they're just desperately struggling with this whole victimization thing, trying to get it in a way which, you know, makes them happy. And what we say, of course, there's no such thing as victimization. There's no exception to it whatsoever. And I'm perfectly comfortable with that. So in relating with Jesus, certainly Jesus is going to say there's no exception. This is his whole purpose, saying there are no exceptions. You must relate with pure abstraction. Pure abstraction means you're not making any exception. Zero means zero. It doesn't mean one. It means zero. No exceptions to truth. This is his whole teaching. This is the whole essence of his teaching. There are no exceptions to truth. And I'm perfectly comfortable with that. Doesn't bother me at all. But most people, this would bother them greatly. They say, well, what about? My mind doesn't go to whatabouts. I don't need to go there anymore. I said, no, there's no, just full stop in the wow. No reason to, you know, play the devil's advocate, so to speak. Say, well, Jesus, what about this poor baby that blah, 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 blah. And I don't need to do that. There's no exceptions. There are no exceptions. Because you have to realize that we have been making decisions previously. We've been engaged with arrogance for who knows, you know, how, quote unquote, long we've been engaged with it. Very, very long time. Jesus says we've overlearned this to an extreme extent. So just because of the fact that we decide that we're going to play the victim one more time and have this body identify with a body that's been born into this world and have something happen to this body, you know, that doesn't mean that we didn't choose that. Just because some body is young doesn't mean the spirit that's identifying with it is young. Or, you know, didn't choose this. Of course, spirit chose this. Whatever happens in a dream is the responsibility of the dreamer. The dreamer is causing everything to happen in the dream. And all time, space, process, and form is simply a dream that we are dreaming. So we're causing all of it to happen. Nothing happens to us. There's no victimization. So I don't have any problem at all relating to this. Now, there's some things that Jesus might say that I'm not quite comfortable with, and I've been working on that for a long time, and I just say, oh, it's okay, you know, that means that I still, you know, have some arrogance I need to let go of, that's fine, but I'm also willing to just full stop in the wow, give Jesus the benefit of the doubt, and say, well, you know, maybe we can talk about something else, we don't have to struggle with this. If this is a struggle, we can look at something else. There's many ways that we can look at it that are helpful, and not panic and not feel guilty or bad about it, and just say, okay, I'll get this soon. I know this will soon come into focus, and just maybe not right now. That's fine, not a problem. Don't beat a panicked retreat. Don't get defensive about it. So I've had a lot of experience with this, not getting overly defensive. It's been a very tough road because, you know, a lot of times I'd say, why? I don't understand this. What are you talking about? You know, this is so difficult. It's too difficult, and get upset about it. I tell you, it's getting quite cold out here, say the least. So, I'll probably just do the regular 2.5 hours with this and call it a day, because it's going to stop anyway, because the my plan in using images to make to extend the taping hasn't worked, but it's been fun anyway, hasn't it? Been fun anyway. A different style of video here. And I want to introduce this kind of loose style here. So very relaxed, very loose, very conversational, showing us that we can relate in friendship with Jesus in a relaxed, conversational, non-pressured way. You know, it's not like, oh my God, Jesus is here, and what he's going to say is, I got to listen to, you know, you got to remember what he says at some point, I got to fixate upon it, and this is the difference between life and death, and eternal life and eternal damnation. I got, no, that's ridiculous. That's ridiculous. It's just, all is already eternal life. It's inescapable. Eternal life is completely inescapable for all of us, no exception. So there's no pressure to get it. You don't have to get it right now. You have however long you take is however long it takes. There's no secret teaching that if you forget it or get it, you know, that's the difference. No, it's repeated and repeated and repeated thousands and thousands and thousands of times. You know, I've repeated everything so many times. Just repeat it again. It's not difficult. It's not complex. So we can just make it conversational like this. It's very simple, actually. Very simple. You must repent in right practice, you know, full stop on the wow practice, which we've introduced here. I know the practice. I know it works. So there's no concern about that. So it can be very conversational. No need to get all like super intense, like, okay, Jesus is now going to give me the secret password. I have to remember the password. There is no secret password, you know. Just repent. You have to set your arrogance down. There's no two ways about it. And this is something that gradually we work up towards, because we're so frightened, and we have to be able to see our defenses as defenses rather than as reality. And then look at these defenses and see and say, wait a minute, you know, maybe it's doing this and trying to do this, and how it's, you know, tricking me into thinking that annihilation is possible. Defenses are very tricky. So sort of an informal, relaxed style here, right? Informal, relaxed. And yet we're covering a lot of very important ground by doing so. It doesn't have to be some sort of formal teaching situation. Like we're in a classroom and we've got a certain amount of time and we've got the text and teacher is teaching or writing down notes. This is what he said, this is what he said, this is what he said. No, I'm not. If I'm with Jesus, am I going to take any notes? I very much doubt it. Very much doubt it. In fact, I've been trained all along. Jesus trained me, don't take any notes. Very important. I never took any notes. Almost never, really. Even to this day, rarely do I ever write down any notes or anything down in that way. Sometimes if I can't remember some dates, I might write them down. But you know, it's almost nothing. Almost no notes. Very free form. It's very important. Because to relate with Jesus, I believe you don't want to take down notes, because then you immediately put Jesus in the role of teacher instead of friend. So he comes back as a friend. A friend can relay the truth to a friend, right, without some sort of formal teaching situation being present, and say, okay, sit there and listen to what I have to say, and you need to take notes on what I say, and so you know exactly what I said, and don't get it wrong, and transmit this as teachings to others exactly like this and this and this. It doesn't have to be that way at all. I mean, the truth is so obvious. You know, it's not like you can lose it. You know, it just. We try to be greater than God. We're trying to make arrogance causative, but it's actually non-causative. So just set it down. That's all. Nothing's happened to reality. It hasn't changed in one bit. Never will. And then we have a continuity problem. We need to practice full stop in the wow, because it shocks us. We're related and we're kind of frightened and sort of stunned by realizing, hey, we're not trapped. We don't have to wait. Reality is not something yet to be determined. We don't have to wait for anything to be determined. It's reality is already the way it is. It's never going to change. So we don't have to wait for some change to take place. We don't have to wait for an outcome of some contest to take place. We don't have to wait at all. And this is very simple stuff. So Jesus says, he told us he was going to return as a friend. He said to his apostles before he left, I see you as all friends. And he's returning as a friend, not as a rabbi, not as a teacher, so to speak, but as a friend who is free of all arrogance, who is very experienced in that, and yet is able to, wants to just say, you know, it's time for you to also be this way, so we can relate as friends instead of this hierarchical relationship of master, guru, teacher, and someone who's very ignorant and has to, you know, struggle with this and try to write down, make notes. I never took notes in school. Never took notes in school, believe it or not. I hated taking notes. I refused to do it. I said, if I can't get at the essence of it by listening to the teacher, then what kind of student am I? What kind of teacher is this, actually? And only the essence is important. I don't care about the other stuff. Just I want the essence of it. So I wasn't very good student, as good as people wanted me to be, because I didn't take notes. I couldn't even read my own handwriting anyway. What's the use? My handwriting was so bad. I went back. If I tried, I'd go back and say, "What? I can't read that. I don't know what the notes are saying." So I said, "This is what's not going to take notes. Forget it. What's the use?" How are we doing on this video? All right. Yep. We're right up there, getting close to the end. So, you know, interesting. So now I've always spontaneously have to get the essence of what's going on right now without notes, without referencing. And so with Jesus is here, am I going to be freaked out? Say, oh my God, I got to take notes. And no. I just say, well, what's the essence of what's being said here? Let's see if I can, you know, if I get it. And I get it. I say, okay, that's good enough. That's good enough. The essence is all that's important. But that opens the door to a more friendship sort of situation, right? Than a hierarchical situation of teacher and student. That's not to say I wouldn't be quiet and listen. Sometimes when a friend says stuff to you, they get more serious. You listen to them, what are they saying? So you can get what they're saying. That's fine too. But a lot of people, the academics, they feel they have to take notes. They have to get whatever is said and put it into some book form, which is fine. It was fine for A Course in Miracles, but for now, you know, I don't see that me doing that sort of thing. I might not be doing something like that. I don't know. I would paraphrase it anyway, sort of. You know, it's difficult for me to verbatim just say exactly what someone said. It's a little difficult. Even in our practicing, like, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. I also say, hey, we are not bodies, we are free. We are still spirit exactly as God created me. Or, I've never been a body. I've always been free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. I don't feel any problem with making these variations, you know, on a theme. Like I said in a previous life, as a musician, a composer, I was an expert on making variations on themes. And I'd introduce a basic theme. And then the composition had a lot to do with just all the different variations on this one theme. A lot of classical music is that way. So I'm very good at variations on themes. This is the basic theme, and then spinning all these, you know, beautiful variations off of that theme. So Jesus might suggest a theme, and I'd say, okay, great, it's a great theme, love it. So let's do this theme. And also we can do variations like, I've never been a body, I've always been free. I am still spirit exactly as God created me. Various variations on that, which is very good for spiritual practice, to be able to keep it creative, keep it fresh, keep it now, and recognize that you're capable of doing this. You know, we're not meant to be just parrots parroting back what is said, like we're these miserable, wretched humans that are inherently inferior to the great divinity of Jesus, and we'll never understand what he really means, and so we just have to be like good little academics and repeat what is said, so he can pat us on the back and say, that's great, you're repeating what I said, that's a wonderful, nice little human being. That's not where it's at. We're not human beings. I've never been a human. I've always been free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me, exactly as God created Jesus, exactly as God created you, exactly as God created all. We're all exactly the same. Why? We have all exactly the same empowerment, which is perfect freedom out of the pure love of God, all having all at always. All having all always. This is what we are, actually. There's no difference at all. We're all the same this way. All the same. Well, we may be having all sorts of different appearance experiencing, but we're all exactly the same in our empowerment, and that never changes in the slightest bit. So it's good for us to do variations on a theme, to feel that we're capable. I've done so many practices in these videos, sharing, you know, so much creativity in this practicing. So I feel very competent with that. It's not a problem for me. So I'm not going to be freaked out if I don't remember exactly what Jesus says. You know, he's already said plenty. You know, we have plenty to work with. when it boils down, you can just say, I'm not a body, I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. And you can practice in the already mode. Yes, I already know that Jesus has already returned. Yes, I already know that I'm already enlightened. Yes, I already know that I'm already empowered. Yes, I already know that I'm already perfectly empowered. Yes, I already know that everyone is already perfectly empowered. You could use this technique of the already technique. It's a very powerful technique. Yes, I already know that everyone is already perfectly empowered by God. Yes, I already know that there's only one empowerment, and all is already perfectly empowered by God, by this one empowerment, which comes from God. Yes, I already know. All of this, this is something I already know. Reminding ourselves that we do already know the truth. Just because we're dreaming doesn't know we don't. You know, do you say that a dreamer has lost all knowledge of reality? Not really. It's still within them. When they awaken from the dream, don't they very quickly say, I know reality. I know how to function here. And forget the dream very quickly. Say, all the stuff happened in the dream, that was all nonsense. Speaking of that, I had a very strange dream. Not a dream, actually. I had a very strange situation take place this morning where I suddenly woke up and I heard someone screaming, screeching my name, trying to relate to me in some way, but it was a frightening way. Wow, it sounded like very metallic, very robotic, very artificial intelligence-ish, terrifying voice, interlocution, terrifying locution. And in fact, the whole night, that rest of the night I spent was shaking. I was very worried that didn't return. I said, oh my gosh, I hope that voice doesn't ever return again to me. You know, it was very scary. Have not had that happen like that so severely ever. There's been a couple of times where I've had locutions, just basically someone saying my name or something. So it sounds like someone wanted to communicate or something. But this one was terrifying. So hopefully it was someone who having to leave, you know, my presence, some sort of defensive projection. It's time for them to go. And maybe they were screeching at me. It was some kind of screech, horrible screech. It was very strong and loud. I woke up and I said, whoa, you know, who was that? It was almost yelling my name. Who was yelling my name? I didn't see anyone there to be yelling my name. And my heart was pounding. I said, wow, someone was yelling my name, but in a most screeching way and frightening way. It's horrible. Maybe someone trying to frighten me from any locution whatsoever. Locution is another term for telepathy, actually. And this is the way that reality... reality doesn't even use telepathy. But those with healed minds often use telepathy. And not only those, but those with unhealed minds, but not using words, also use telepathy. The extraterrestrials use telepathy a lot. And so telepathy is a much more normal way of communication in the cosmos than the way we're using words. We all are wireless. We all, actually, the brain is a wireless computer, basically. It's able to communicate without, you know, without any, directly, mind-to-mind, brain-to-brain, so to speak. We're all capable of that. Now, I should have said to this voice, hey, if you want to converse with me, be civil about it. Don't scream at me in such a horrible tone, you know. Say, hey, introduce yourself in a very nice, serene, and calm, polite way. If that's how you want to do it. My gosh, this was very uncivil, the voice. So I take it as maybe someone is getting booted out of my psyche and not going to have access anymore, and they're very upset about it. Because this goddess defense has had access, and I've been trying to get rid of it, for sure. Trying to get rid of that, and this sounded like as if someone's screaming and so angry at me that they're no longer going to have access to me.